morning, everyone. Now we will be discussing about communication and identity construction, a topic that I believe most of us are conscious and wary about, especially with today's age. A lot of the millennials, a lot of the younger generation are actually quite confused about who they are as individuals. So before we start with our deeper discussion on the different theories of identity, we have to first discuss the three dimensions of the self. These are actually very integral in order to make us know and appreciate ourselves better and to make us realize that our self is not just what we see in front of the mirror. There are actually different dimensions to our one self. So first we go now to the material self. Obviously, when we talk about something that is material, we talk about something that we see, we talk about something that we something that we can feel. When we look in front of the mirror, this is the material self that we have. But more than just the material physical face that we have, we also talk about your body movements, the gestures that you have, how stiff you are, how confident you are when you're walking, the kinds of voice that you use. All of these are part of your material self. But we move on and we now discuss the second dimension, which is the social self. So when we're trying to discuss the social self, we have to keep in mind that when we try to discuss ourselves as human beings, we're not only referring to ourselves as what we see in the mirror. We also try to include what do people know of us? Are you someone who is known as a loner? Are you an antisocial? Or are you someone who is very good with communicating with other people? These different categories of yourself or how people know you to be you is also considered as a social self. But we also have the more important one, and this is normally the one that we neglect the most, the spiritual self. So before we move on, we have to discuss first, no? When we talk about the spiritual self, we're not actually referring to something religious or something transcendental. We're only simply referring to the mechanisms in our brain, the mental processes, the thought processes that we have, because these compose our spiritual self. So we discuss here what are your values, what are your aspirations. You're probably, most of you are in freshman or probably graduating, and a lot of you probably don't know yet what you want to pursue when you graduate. When we talk about the spiritual self, we also discuss what are your belief systems, what are your ideologies, the things that compose the abstract parts of yourself and the things that you want to pursue later on. So when we look at these three concepts of the material, social, and spiritual self, we have to keep in mind that we could have some downsides if we focus too much on one aspect. Say, for example, a focus on the material self. We are running the tendency, and we see this a lot, especially with the onset of Instagram, of Facebook, of Twitter, and the incessant need and tendency to just take a picture of yourself in front of the mirror or take a lot of selfies. A focus of too much on the material self will have you running the risk of being a narcissistic individual. On the other hand, people who focus too much on the social self are running the risk of becoming known as people pleasers. Why do we say this? Because when you focus too much on the social aspect of yourself, what you just want to do is simply to be able to please other people. Sometimes even to the detriment of yourself, sometimes even if it is too hard on your part already, but because you want to keep on pleasing whatever it is that other people are asking from you, then you are running the risk of being known as a people pleaser. On the other hand, and this is where the problem lies, a lot of people are focused on the material and even the social self, and they are sometimes forgetting the spiritual aspect. If we do not know ourselves, or sometimes if we only know ourselves only through what we see in front of the mirror, or we only know ourselves only because of what we hear from other people say about us, then we are running the tendency to fall into a lack of knowing our self-concept. And with this, we will see a lot of problems that may arise as we progress. So we now move on to the... These are several concepts in relation to the concept of the self that we all know, we all hear, we all throw around these words, but what do these words actually mean? So we will briefly go through this one by one. First, we had the concept of the self, or what we call a self-concept. Self-concept is, these are the things that you know about yourself, but the one thing that we have to remember, and one thing that I always tell my students to keep in mind when we discuss the concept of the self-concept, is that you have the power to choose whether you want to integrate that concept of yourself to yourself. So what do we mean by this? Sometimes you hear some people, they say some things about you that you don't necessarily agree with, things that you won't say na, hindi naman talaga ako to eh, or pananaw lang ng isang tao yan, that's not really me. So when we discuss the concept of self-concept, we have to keep in mind that you have the power, you have the agency to decide whether or not you want to make that narinig mo sa ibang tao as part of your self-concept or not. So in short, we should not be hearing or we should not be caught off guard saying that, eh, ito ako eh, kasi ito yung sinabi ng ibang tao tungkol sa akin. So we should not be falling under the trap simply because we have the capacity and the agency to stop and not retain it as part of our self-concept. Next is we have the concept of self-awareness. So dito baka medyo pumasok yung concept ng yoga or, you know, transcendence and things like this. But when we talk about self-awareness in relation to self-concept, this only refers to what we know of ourselves. So if you, most of you, I believe, have gone through case 11 and 12 already, and you probably have heard of the Johari window. So what is the significance of the Johari window here? The Johari window has four panes. So we have the open pane, the blind pane, the hidden pane, and the unknown. So the open pane discusses the things that you know of yourself and what other people know about you. So this refers to your name, your age, where you live, what you look like. These are the things that you don't keep from other people because it's pretty obvious already. And the next is we have the hidden pane. For the hidden pane, we talk about the things that you know about yourself but you are hiding from other people. So probably some people have the hidden pain as the biggest of all the four pains simply because they have a lot of things that they keep to themselves. The things that, you know, the deepest, darkest, the things that you are very worried that other people find out about you. So a lot of people try to keep the hidden really hidden. The third pain is we have the blind pain. So from the term itself, it's blind, meaning we are blinded to it. These are the things that other people know about us, but things that probably we are not really aware about ourselves. So how would you know kung ano ilalagay mo sa blind pain? Normally, this would come about when you ask other people. So whenever I have my students do the Johari window, sometimes they get surprised. And I always tell them na they shouldn't fight or quarrel with the one who has put included things there because sometimes we're not just aware that we're doing things na might be wrong or might be problematic to some people, but it's good that we hear from other people because then we become more aware of it and there's something that we can do to change it. And then the last pain is the unknown pain. What do we put? You don't know it, I don't know it, no one knows it, so what are the things that we include in the unknown pain? So we put here the things that our future. We don't know what our future is. We don't know the time of death. We don't know what career you will have 5-10 years from now. When you graduate, will you immediately go to work or will you be someone who's going to be a bum for 7 months like me? You know, things like this. So these are the four different pains that when we are more aware of it, then we will be able to manage our self-awareness more. So the third one is self-confidence. Alam natin yan, diba? It's one of the buzzwords that we keep throwing around. Yung kumpiyansa, yung confidence ko sa sarili ko. So what are we exactly referring to when we talk about self-confidence? Self-confidence refers to your belief sa iyong sarili, okay? This is the how you feel that you are able to handle yourself in certain situations, your belief in your ability to do something. That's what we call as self-confidence. So normally, kapag ka mababa ang self-awareness or you don't know yourself much, then it will follow that because you don't know yourself much, you don't have the confidence to do things because you don't know what your weaknesses, what your strengths are. It would be harder for you to grapple with it and it will be harder for you to address what your weaknesses are. So for this, we have, so makikita natin na tuloy-tuloy ito. From self-concept down to self-awareness, which will hopefully lead to self-confidence. And the next is we have self-esteem. Self-esteem is simply the value that you put on yourself. This is the value that you place on yourself simply because you believe, because you already know what your strengths and your weaknesses are. You know what the things that you have to work on are. So because you already know all of these things, you are now more able to believe in yourself and to put value or esteem in yourself. With all four discussions here would become, these are all moot points if you are not able to discuss self-understanding. Self-understanding is very, very important. And for me, I believe that of the five, this is what we have to really sit down and understand well about ourselves. So what is self-understanding? Self-understanding simply means that this is our healthy view of ourselves. So when we talk about a healthy view of ourselves, we're referring to both the good and the bad. We talk about the what are the worst things that you have done in your life, what are the best things that you envision yourself that you could do, and this is a whole wide spectrum. So when we talk about self-understanding, what we have to keep in mind here is we're not just trying to understand or to keep in mind that ay, ito ako. You just discuss all of the good things. When we talk about self-understanding, we also have to keep in mind that oo, ikaw to, pero ikaw din to. So it's a whole spectrum of things, both good and bad. And for us to be able to keep ourselves grounded, in order for us to not be, you know, to fall into sadness or depression because there are a lot of things, unrealistic things that we are pressuring ourselves with, one good thing to keep in mind is that we have to be able to understand and accept all good and bad from ourselves. So these are the five different concepts of the self, and hopefully it has already given you better understanding in order for us to move along to the other parts of identity construction, because it is essential, as we will see in what we have, the five concepts that we've discussed, this is a focus on the self only. But when we look at the other theories, we will see that when we really talk about our identity, it's not just really about ourselves only. We will see this as we prepare to look at this one. T.S. Eliot has once said, prepare a face to meet the faces that you meet. Daming mukha. Okay? Prepare a face to meet the faces that you meet. So what do we mean by this exactly? Number one, we have to keep in mind that when we talk about the face, we're not only referring to your physical face that you see in the mirror. When we talk about the face, well, according to Stella Ting Tumi, the face is the projected self-image. This is the face that you prepare, the self-image that you prepare in order to project to other people. Depending on what you want to be perceived by, then that is the kind of face that you will be preparing to meet. But the important thing to keep note here is that we are also preparing a face to meet other faces that we're meeting. And I think this is one thing that we have to keep in mind, because the fact that sometimes we're so engrossed with looking at ourselves and trying to be the best kinds of individuals that we are, but when we go and meet other people, we will be surprised that these people have different faces as well. So what does it mean? We're all preparing faces. We're all different faces. So that one face that you meet will not always be that face. It could be a different face on a different occasion, depending on a different situation, it would be different. So what is the bottom line here? Because we are all preparing faces, number one, we have to keep in mind that we have to have a concept of decorum, the concept of mutual politeness, mutual respect. Why? Because even if, for example, I am super mad at someone, especially when you watch the news now, no? There are a lot of things that will make us mad, and it's very easy to just curse at people. It's very easy to just say that, you know, they're bobo or something like that. But when we keep in mind that we have to prepare our face to meet other faces, then we have to keep in mind that what we're doing is actually preparing to meet also the worst in them. And because we want to see, we are realizing and acknowledging the fact that we all have the worst in us, that when we are preparing our face to meet these different faces, we are already projecting what we can be, the best that we can be, so that when we meet that negative one, we won't stoop down to that level. Why? Because when you talk about our identity construction, remember, we have to keep in mind, when we talk about ourselves, it also includes what other people know of us. And if other people know of us to be people who are, you know, easily angered, people who easily lose hope, or walang tiwala sa ibang tao, then that could cause us a problem for us, so our self-identity as well. So we always have to keep in mind that because we are all preparing different kinds of faces, we have to keep our best faces up front. And with that statement, no, we always have to be prepared with keeping our best faces forward, then it would seem that what we are actually doing is sort of it's pretentious. To say the least, no? It could be pretentious. But actually, what we are discussing here now is the concept of Goffman, presentation of self. So when we look at the presentation of self and we talk about dramaturgy, simply what this is referring to is the fact that all of us, each individual, we all have our front stage and our backstage. Front stage, you can imagine, when you are in front of the stage, you are a different actor. You are portraying whatever other elements are there, whatever character it is that you want to portray, then that's what you portray. So each one of us have our own front stage. And this front stage may be different from other people. So this is because we have different front stages with different individuals, this is where the props come in. So when we talk about props, we talk about the different sometimes the clothing, the artifacts that we have, the different nonverbal elements that we have, sometimes even how we talk, how we walk, all of these we are projecting to other people simply because we want to impress them. This is where impression management comes in because as we said a while ago, we are preparing a different kind of face to each individual that we need. We are trying to manage our impressions on them. And because we are trying to manage our impressions on them, how I am now in front of you is very different from how I am with my family, for example, or when I'm with my friends. So it depends on who you're talking to, then we are able to manage our impressions more effectively. But important thing that we have to keep in mind, and I feel that this is also very significant, is our discussion of the backstage. So when we talk about the backstage, this is where, you know, diba, when you watch plays, for example, or musicals, diba, bababa na yung curtain, and then you move back, and then the actors can now relax and say na, tapos na, so they can be their true selves already. So this is similar to the concept of the backstage. When we are talking with other people, for example, you have a whole day, you're in school, you're teaching, you're being a student, you're a daughter or a son to your parents, then those are all front stage. Your backstage could be your sanctuary, where you are most comfortable, where you are most relaxed to being yourself, simply because you can be informal with yourself, with no thoughts of being judged or ridiculed by other people for who you are as an individual. And it's also very important to note here that the backstage is very important. Why? Because if we neglect our backstage, if we neglect going back to our own selves and grounding ourselves into who we are, then we might all be just about pretenses and impression management without really going back to our roots, to who we are really as individuals. So it has to be a perfect balance between the front stage and the backstage. Moving on, we now go to the communication theory of identity. And as I said a while ago, when we talk about the self, we're focusing more on the different aspects of ourself only. But when we look at the communication theory of identity, we will now see that actually, our identities are not just our own. It is a byproduct of other things also. Okay, so what does this mean? Identity itself is communication, identity as communication. We should not think of our identity simply as a product of nag-usap yung dalawang tao, ito yung alam nila sa'yo, then that's your identity. It's not simply that. When we talk about identity, how you communicate with other people, how you project, the things that go on when you're moving around, these are also parts of your identity. So identity is not only seen in the as the product or the end goal. This is you. While you're communicating, while you're doing things, this is identity. Okay? So there are two very important things that we have to keep in mind here. First is the context of social relations and roles. So, di ba, sabi natin kanina, you're a son, you're a daughter, you're a sister, you're a brother, you're a class president, you're a classmate, whatever those are. These are social relations and roles that are sort of imposed upon you by other people. And because you are perceived as this way by other people, you are internalizing it as part of yourself. So makikita natin, this is coming from the outside going in because you're internalizing these different roles, these different relations and conventions of how you should act coming from other people. On the other hand, because of the internalized role that we have from other people, then we produce our individual identities. So ngayon, from other people going to you as an individual. And then now you as an individual, as we said a while ago, you have the self-concept, self-awareness, self-understanding, all of these things will work hand in hand with what we know of other people's impressions of us, then the social and the individual will merge, and then now you are able to act out that social behavior through the communication behaviors or patterns that you have. So ibig sabihin, pag pinag-uusapan natin ang konsepto ng identity according to CTI, what we are referring to here is not just you acting out, period. Kasi pagka ganun yung pananaw natin, it's very easy to say that we're acting out depending on impulses, depending on what comes in our head, that's how we act. But we have to keep in mind that because first and foremost, we also take into account society's impressions of us or what they believe us to do, how we are supposed to act, and it will work hand in hand with our identity and how we view ourselves, then now we are able to act out in a more socially acceptable manner. Under the CTI, there are four frames of identity. So, di ba kanina, may five concepts na discuss. Ngayon naman, we have four frames of identity that are also all part of your own identity. Okay, so first one is personal identity. Personal identity refers to yon, who you are as an individual. Your self-concept, your self-awareness, how you view yourself, personal nga. Ito yung pananaw mo sa sarili mo. Next is we have enacted identity. From the term itself, it is something that you enact. It is something that you perform. It is something that you express. But you have to keep in mind here that when we talk about enacted identity, we're not just merely talking about expressions per se, but we're trying to realize that how you express yourself is actually your identity also. So they go hand in hand. Okay? And then thirdly, we have what we refer to as relational identity. So, yung relational identity in relation to. Okay? So, paano nangyari to? First is we have relational identity through first, internalizing. In relation to what other people know about you, you internalize the role. Next, relational identity in relation to relationship with other people. So, I believe that I just don't believe, but I know that I'm a teacher. Okay? But I'm not just a teacher because in relation to a co-teacher, then that's another relational identity. In relation to my parent, that's another relational identity. And this is where sometimes the problem comes in. Because sometimes if we are not able to manage our identities well, they could overlap or sometimes nagkakagulo siya. So as a teacher, it is my job to be a bit more strict or stern with my students. You know, I have a very authoritative voice. But when I'm at home with my family, with my parents especially, and we come into an argument, it is very common for me to talk like this. And if I'm talking like this in front of my parents, it has happened a lot of times already that they scold me for being that way because it would appear na parang sinesermonan ko daw sila. Eh, hindi ko naman daw sila estudyante. That could happen when we are not able to manage our relational identities well. Okay, so third is we have through relationships with other identities. So, you have, yeah, so for example, you are a student, but you're also a leader, but you're also a sister, you're also a, what are you? A church leader or something, okay? So we have all of these different identities that we all have to grapple with. And lastly, we have relationship as a unit of identity. So, for example, no, we've written here the term couple. Sometimes, if you are known as an individual unit, but at the same time, you are known also as the boyfriend or the girlfriend of this person, or you are best known as, for example, as the chairperson of this particular organization, then your identity is not just your own identity, but coupled with it is the identity of the other unit that you are associated with. Or if not the unit, then the organization where you are associated with. So lastly, we have communal identity reflected. Okay, sorry. It's communal identity that is reflected through collective identity. So what do we mean by this one? I have my own identity. Sabi nga natin sa relational identity, I have different identities. Balik tayo sa faces, the concept of the faces a while ago. And all of these identities within me, that's mine. And when I talk to another person, this person will also have their own sets of different kinds of identities. When you talk to everyone around us, we all have different kinds of identities. So, dito tumapasok yung tinatawag natin na collective identities. Because when we talk or refer to other people, we're not just talking about their singular identity, but instead, we're talking about collective identities that could probably be influenced by culture, by ideologies, by belief systems. And yon, importante na malaman natin na anong identity ba or sino ba ang kausap natin because we will be able to manage our communicative patterns better by that. Okay, so medyo madami na, no? So next is we have the concept of interpenetration. So from the term itself, penetrate, interpenetrate. So ganyan siya, it's an interweaving of, okay? But it's not simply an interweaving of, but it is actually what we refer to as dialectical interpenetration. So the concept of dialectics, opposing, clashing, contradicting, and that is what we see when we are talking with other people, when we are communicating with other people. There is dialectical interpenetration. Ibig sabihin, madami silang frames and it contradicts, it is ambiguous with different frames of other people. So makita natin, no? That's why is there a need to study communication? Diba? Bakit yung kailangan pagdaanan ng content? Ganyan. Kasi dito natin makita na it's not a simple matter. Because of the dialectical tensions that may arise with our different frames of identities, we have to be able to manage them more effectively. And in a way, we should not feel bad about this because it is only proof that we are fluid, we are dynamic identities. Diba, imagine how boring life would be kung yung identity mo yun lang forever na gano'n lang, hindi nag-iiba. Ang pangit nun, diba? So because it's dynamic, because it's fluid, because we are human beings, then obviously we will come into dialectical interpenetration and different dialectical tensions with other people. And that's normal. That's part of life. We have to deal with it. And hopefully, as we keep in mind how important the concept of the other is, then we will be able to manage it more effectively. Okay? So we also have the term identity gap. So ano tong identity gaps na to? ito yung gap nga, di ba? So, what I know of myself, the different frames that I have, and you, that's what you know, those are the different identities and different frames that you have, sometimes there is a gap, meaning hindi tayo nag-meet halfway. The discrepancies arise, and this will cause communication problems or communication tensions, okay? So, importante na ma-manage natin to. So, when we talk about identity gaps, we have to keep in mind that these things arise simply because we have collective or different identities. So, collective identities refer to the to our identity based on social categorization and group membership. Ito na. Dito na tayo, it gets a little bit more complicated simply because, ito na, may social categories na, mayroon tayong group memberships na tinatawag. So, syempre, because we all have different ideologies, we all have different values and different aspirations, excuse me, we will tend to form groups or different organizations or different belongingness with people who share similar things. And this collective identity should be well and good. Pero babalik na tayo sa sinabi natin kanina. Simply because we have the concept of interpenetration, then when one collective identity or one group, okay, will come into contact with another group and they have very differing, very discordant ideologies and views, then it definitely, they will get into an identity gap and further dialectical interpenetration. So dito nagkakaroon ng problema. Okay? So collective identities refer to basically, yan, the different racial, ethnic, national, religious, organizational identities that we belong to. So sobrang dami ito. One person have lots of different kinds of identities and it's normal. So hindi tayo, ano yung tawag doon? We don't have a split personality or we're not schizophrenic. We simply, or multiple personality disorder. We simply just have different identities. So next, we go to the topic of intersectionality. Okay? Sorry, babasahin ko lang medyo mahaba. According to YEP 2015, intersectionalities are how the vectors of difference. The difference here refers to the different role categorization, different memberships that we have. Come together, how these differences, magkakaiba, come together simultaneously to produce social identities and experiences in the social world, from privilege to oppression. So dito na pumapasok yung sinasabi natin kanina na when we talk about our own identity, yes, we are referring to ourselves, but we have to have the concept of the other. Bakit natin kailangan pag-usapan ng ibang tao when we talk about our own identities? Kasi yung question na to ay critical perspectives in communication. And in keeping with the critical paradigm, it is always about trying to forward social change, to trying to better the situation of the oppressed, of the unprivileged, of the disempowered, and trying to help give them a space to be able to express themselves better. So, in collective identities natin, because we will always come into contact with people who are different from us, if we understand correctly that we all have our different places or different privileged positions, then we will be able to adapt well when we are communicating with people who are different from us. Okay, so dito na pumapasok yung ayan, collective identities and power struggles. Bakit power struggles? Kasi nga, sinabi natin a while ago that when we talk about other people, some of them are not, we're all in different planes. Okay, magkakaiba tayo ng levels of privilege. And because of that, there will always be someone who will be more dominant, there will always be someone who would be the sub or the marginalized. Okay, so if you are the dominant, siyempre, ang pagtingin mo doon sa mas mababa sa'yo, this could come in the form of ethnocentrism or sexism. It is the looking down on someone simply because you feel that you are the more superior one. On the other hand, this power struggle may be manifested also in the form of the marginalized. So it's not always the dominant lang who can speak. Okay, the marginalized can also speak. So how does it happen? It depends on how they reconstruct, how they tell and retell their stories. Yung collective stories nila, yung narratives ng grupo nila, yung narratives, for example, ng if they are an indigenous group, how do they tell their stories? What myths do they hold? And sometimes, these are empowering narratives because in their telling, their memories, these memories become cultural memories that are kept alive in the process of telling the story. No? So makita natin dito na when we talk about collective identities and power struggles, although most of the time, it is the dominant who speaks, or it is the dominant who we hear, we have to not neglect the fact that even the marginalized have their own way of reconstructing their stories as well. Okay? Papasok nandito yung concept ng positioning. So what is positioning? Diba? Pumuposisyon, parang sa Tagalog, pupusisyon ka. Although medyo negative yung connotation kasi when you talk about pupusisyon ka, pangit eh, diba? Pupusisyon. Pero when we talk about positioning, at least in the concept of positioning theory, what we are trying to do here is realize and acknowledge the fact that we have our collective identities, but we always try to renegotiate kumbaga, my collective identity, my identity is not just this one. When I am faced with someone who may be more disempowered or less privileged than I am, then I am able to renegotiate my identity in the face of the other person. So, kumbaga, hindi mo ipapamukha kung anong meron ka. Kung hindi, itatry mo i-renegotiate kung paano ka makipag-communicate because you want to be more effective. You want to have a more fruitful conversation or communication with them. So you will have to be able to renegotiate your identity when talking with people with an equal power. Okay? So na, yung second theory natin. Identity, positioning, and self-other relations. Actually, according to Davis and Harry, a subject position, okay, it's not, when we talk about the subject position, this is identity also, but okay, sige, pause muna tayo. Identity kasi has the, when we talk about identity, it has the notion that what we are referring to is an essentialized self, meaning it is something that is, it is innate from us, within us, it is something that is, it doesn't change, it is there, it's innate in you, okay? But Davis and Harriet chose to use the word subject position to refer to the fact that we're not just innately identified as a particular person, okay? We have different subject positions. Bakit subject position? Kasi pwede nating ilipat yung locations natin. Pwede tayong mag-iba-iba. So paano nangyari to? A subject position incorporates both a conceptual repertoire and the location for persons within the structure of rights and duties for those who use that repertoire. Yung konsepto ng rights and duties dito, meaning, ikaw to, ito yung mga gusto mong gawin. Ito yung gusto mong gawin pag nakapag-usap ka sa ibang tao. Dapat ganito yung mangyari. Pero, if we keep in mind that when we are locating ourselves in this position and there are other people who are located in that position, then we have to keep in mind that meron tayong sinusunod, may structure sign na sinusunod dito. Meron tayong mga pwedeng codes of conduct or pwedeng, you know, simply being polite to other people. What are the rights? What are the duties? What are the responsibilities that come with being in that particular position? Kaya nag-iiba-iba siya, depending on where we are located. So once having taken up a particular position as one's own, o, nag-decide ka, dito ka muna, papuesto, yan. A person inevitably sees the world from the vantage point of that position. Nag-iiba ka ngayon. You adapt a different, not a different persona, but you adapt a different worldview in keeping with the worldview of the people where you are located in. Yun importante doon, makikibagay ka sa kanila. In terms of the particular images, metaphors, storylines, and concepts which are made relevant within the particular discursive practice in which they are positioned. Simply put, when you put yourself in that place, you are, yes, you are bringing with you the things that you know of yourself, you're bringing with you your identity, your different, you know, whatever self-concept you have of yourself. But when you go there, if we want to have a successful, effective communication with the other, then what we have to do is to be able to strip them or set them aside. And when we talk with them, we use their metaphors, we use their images, we use their stories, we use their languages. Why? Because it will be, we will have a more effective conversation with them. Bakit? Kasi diba, isa sa mga models of communication, sinasabi na shared experiences. If the language that you're using is very different from these particular people, then how will you have a successful conversation with them? Hindi mangyayari yun. No? So, kailangan kung anong position, kung nasa ang position ka, kung saan position mo nilagay ang sarili mo because you are the one who decides to go there, then you have to keep in mind that you have to be able to adapt to them. Okay? Why? Because adapting to them, using similar, sometimes dressing up the way they are dressing up, sometimes using the language that they're using, sometimes simply setting aside the concept that we have more privilege than them, we will have more effective conversations and more effective communication with them. Why? Kasi yung understanding nandun. And so that's very important, especially when we're talking about positionalities with the concept of the other. Okay, so ito na, basically. Sige. Sinasabi dito ng positioning theory ni Harry et al. Okay? So when we talk about identity, ito yung sinasabi natin kanina. Yes, we are building up from the concept of the self, which is purely you lang, lahat ng naiisip mo, lahat ng alam mo na sinasabi ng ibang tao tungkol sa'yo. But now we have the concept of your identity is not just this, nilang ikaw yan. Your identity will involve other people as well. What do we mean? How you identify with them, how you communicate, how you converse with them, how you interact with other people who are different from you, then that should also form part of your identity. Marunong ka ba makisalamuha sa ibang tao? O sasantabi ka na lang dahil ayaw mo makisalamuha sa kanila, no? Those, all of these will form part of your identity as well, okay? So because we're referring to the de-essentialized identity, meaning identities na nag-iiba-iba depending on who we are talking to, then we have to keep in mind that a concept of identity and the self are always discursively produced. What does it mean? You are never the same in any kind of communication situation. You are always changed. How? Why? By your interaction with the other person. Kaya discursively produced yan. You know, no matter how much you want to remain as is, when you talk to other people, when you actually truly converse with other people, then you are discursively changing yourself. Not really changing yourself, pero naiiba ka in the process. Why? Because you're influenced by that interaction. Okay? So sinasabi natin dito, paano ka naiiba? Okay, how is this discursively produced? Through our use of language, okay? Sometimes, sabi natin na we have to modify how we use our language when we're talking to certain kinds of people. But at the same time, not only is our language different, but how we produce meanings, what we know of things, will become different. Why? Because when you talk to other people, di ba, we get out of our comfort zones, we get out of our own little bubbles, naboburst yan minsan, depending on their stories, and our meanings change. Sometimes, especially if the story of the other is yung talaga makabagbag damdamin or grabe talaga yung mga pinagdadaanan nila, you cannot help but be changed. Your meanings about certain things, your meaning about life, about how you converse, will definitely change. So ito yung sinasabi natin kanina. Okay? According to the positioning theory, the concept of identity is the here, it is the now. What do we mean by this one? Your identity is not something that you have established when you were 5 years old or when you were in high school. Nung panahon namin, uso yung autograph. Hindi ko alam kung hindi siguro alam ng mga students yan. When we talk about the autograph, yun yung name mo, yung crush mo, sa ka nag-aaral, favorite colors, yung mga ganyan, okay? So when you talk about your identity, we're not referring to those things that you have written years ago. Your identity is here. This is now. How are you as an individual? How are you when you're communicating with other people? That is your identity. Hindi yung binabalikan mo na sana ito pa rin ako. Hindi yon. Ang identity mo ay ito. At hindi lang yung ito, kung hindi, how you are doing your identity. And this is very significant. Bakit? Kasi when we talk about the doing identities, what we are referring to here is that we don't just talk about things. We do things. You don't just talk about yourself as being like this. You do yourself being like this. So ibig sabihin, maiiwasan natin dito, you know, being very, you know, hypocritical individuals that we keep on saying something and then doing something else. So according to the positioning theory, doing identities will help ground us because it is in our doing that we get to identify with ourselves better. We get to know ourselves better. And maiiwasan natin yung mga, kunwari gato tayo pa hindi naman talaga. Ganon. Sabi natin kanina, di ba, sometimes you have to adapt the stories, the languages that they use. Ito yung sinasabi natin. Depending on our position, then the images that they have, the metaphors that they're using, the storylines that they're using to construct their narratives, their plays, their myths, ito dapat yung somehow may imbibe natin at gagamitin din natin pag nagkakwento tayo. Bakit? Because this is simple baseline respect for them as well. Hindi na tinatanong yun. Respeto lang yun. Okay? So the concept now of the self and the other, sabi natin nga dahil it is discursively produced, discursively reproduced, ano nangyari dito? In our conversations with other people, especially if we try to locate ourselves in locations where there's a very wide gap between the dominant and the oppressed, mas makita natin that we are constantly reproducing our identities, okay? But the important thing that we have to keep in mind here is when we are reproducing these identities, we're not just referring to yung identities natin na sa pakikipag-usap lang nila. Pero, because in our talking to them, we know that baka tayo yung mas may power na magsalita kasi tayo yung mas dominant. And baka oo lang sila ng oo kasi they have lesser power. Diba? They don't want to offend us kasi sino ba naman sila, ganyan. Dito pumapasok yung concept ng power relations kasi because we know that these people will speak from their vantage point, now we are more able to empower them, to uplift them in order to make them express themselves better. At the very least, to be on semi-equal playing field when we are conversing with them. I came up with this, referring to the theories na binanggit natin kanina. Basically, nahati itong identities natin into two, the inter-individual identities, which is more social representation ang pinanggagalingan. And on the other hand, we have the critical identities, which is more discursive in approach, okay? So, doon muna tayo sa social representation. Actually, these two, when we talk about the position theory, pareho sila na pinanggagalingan, nagkakaiba lang sa kung ano yung outcome na gusto nila. Okay? So, for the social representation side, they acknowledge that there is an unequal playing field. Kasi nga, di ba, you have the more privilege, you have the lesser privilege, and all of these different power play, power struggles, and definitely, unequal ang playing field nito. At dahil unequal ang playing field, may merong mga tao na mas kayang magsalita at meron yung mga mas namumute. Okay? So, bargaining privilege, the dominant. Bakit? Kasi, you have, you know ba, you're more learned, you're more intelligent, then mas bold ka magsalita, mas madami ka alam, mas pwede ka madaming sabihin. Pag yung isang tao hindi nakapag-aral, baka mas limited lang yung pwede niya sabihin, okay? For the social representation side, they acknowledge that these people can also speak. Yun nga lang, dahil nga yung isang grupo ay mas privileged, sila ang mas may kaya magsalita sa mas malakas na paraan. We also have the concept of co-cultural groups, okay? Or the who we refer to as the minorities. So minorities can come in the form of yung mga indigenous groups natin, or yung mga gays natin, mga lesbians, mga poor, okay? These different kinds of disempowered people. There is an acknowledgement from the social representation side that these people are muted, okay? So dahil muted sila, they try to negotiate identities. Paano? Yung internal struggles nila, yung makinakaharap nila, at the same time, external struggles that they face when they communicate with someone who is different from them, then doon lumalabas yung negotiation. But normally, ang problema dito kasi, when we talk about the internal and external struggles, they always fall victim. There is always the implicit notion that because they are poorer, because they are lesser, then they cannot communicate in the same way or in the same playing field as the one who is more dominant. Okay, so parating silang victim, parating marginalized, as opposed to the dominant, who is the more has the title of being the oppressor. Yeah. Okay? So ano naging result nito? Ina-acknowledge sila na may institutional oppressive power. Okay? 'Di ba yung ISAs natin, 'di ba yung mga ideological state apparatuses, there are different mechanisms in place that are meant to subject us now or control us to make us follow what they want us to do. May acknowledgement na ganyan ang social representation. But the problem here is, normally, it becomes identity resistance and intergroup separation lang. You know, they try to resist, they voice out their opinion, they try to rebel, for example, against the government, things like that. But it stops there, okay? Dito pumapasok ngayon yung discursive approach. Bakit? Kasi sa discursive approach, alam niya na dahil may different power struggle, dahil unequal yung playing field, it is not enough to show your resistance. Baka there is something that can be done to meet halfway. Okay, so paano pumapasok to dito? Yung identity negotiation nila is in the form of persuasive communication, using proper rhetoric. Bakit nila gustong gamitin ang rhetoric? Kasi mas pwede na silang, di ba, if you're able to provide supporting arguments, then it is possible that the other side, whom you previously viewed only as someone who you are able to resist, now you can see din na mas someone na, ay, baka pag kinausap ko siya, pwede ko makuha yung side niya. Baka maintindihan na rin niya, ma-persuade ko siya. So, ganun yung pagtingin ng discursive approach. So, it is more towards collaborative partnership through dialogue and mutual identity valuation. So, meron dito yung konsepto ng, yes, we're different, but I will not just keep on pushing what I want and you just keep pushing what you want and we fight over it. So, discursive approach, dahil nga may discourse, alam natin na meron an equal power play. So, what we will do now is, as much as possible, depending on the rhetorical tools that are available to us, which we will be discussing rhetoric naman. So, ang gagawin natin dito, gagamitin natin to rhetorical tools na to in order to try to persuade them on our side. So, mas maganda ito ang gagamitin natin kasi at the very end, hindi lang tayo magkakaroon ng separation or intergroup separation. Instead, what we will have is hopefully, it will result to a multicultural identity with co-cultural or dominant vulnerable selves. Meaning, we don't just see ourselves as distinctly different. But because of our conversations with them, we get to hear their side. Malay mo, may punto din naman pala sila na pwede natin pakinggan. So in that sense, we get a more holistic understanding. So now when we communicate, even if you still don't agree with their side, but because you are now able to understand them, then now you are able to tweak or change a little bit of your rhetoric kung paano kayo makapag-usap sa kanila para hindi paaway parati, para hindi parati pag-galit. Kung hindi, the end goal of this one, why we want to discourse with other people and consider other people and the unequal playing field that we have, is to be able to see na baka meron tayong common ground na pwedeng ma-reach. Okay? So, it could be all about trying to look for the common ground, trying to see where we could both stand. You know, we all have different ideologies, but if you could find that perfect spot where we could both communicate without fighting or quarreling with each other, then it would be a successful communication. So there. Hopefully you learn something. Medyo madaming concepts of identity. Bottom line here is that if we really want to be UPians, no, who have good identities, na parang something we can be proud of, it is all about looking at yourself, understanding yourself, having a healthy view of yourself. But at the same time, we do not lose touch from our surroundings. Why? Because we have to be grounded in social reality. If we know our social realities, if we know what other people are going through, and we are able to communicate with them, and sometimes from their perspective, then it could result to more successful and effective communication. Thank you.